Además de cuando a tu 15 no retiro la cosa. Me ocupata.
Ah, pasa.
Make co-host. Okay. So,
as a co-host, to know that we are not going to be participants. You don't need to do that. They're all on the meeting.
Okay, that's right.
Yes, and then enter. So, we're going to wait everyone to come out of the meeting. Everyone in the meeting room and everyone in the meeting room.
So, and the occupying room are from Korea?
No. They will see that message. Then, in November, we'll be starting in the next. We'll open the room in the next.
So, welcome.
Welcome, everyone, for today. Just have a welcome. Thank you for wanting joining us. We will be opening the session in at 10:55.
Thank you for joining us.
Today. Yeah, we'll be opening at 10:55.
Welcome. Thank you for joining us today.
So you can actually be at a meeting. No, I mean that can be one of the things you do. And the other thing I wanted you to do, become on the Zambia Unachat Mabeho, where you are yes, when the meeting is going on, they can read Babu, Pukishan's a presentation on Zambia. You can chat your question on chat as and then they can be answered you. Okay, come up at Kifana overview. Naweza nikifanya hii overview, nawaambia, naweza andika message hapo. Kindly share with us the industry you are in. In accounting and finance, blah, blah, so that we test that they have understood how to use chat. Yeah. Then, hii ndio, hizi ni za nini, then, uru nawaambia, put your questions on chat, as a speaker, and then you can share at the end. So me instead of focusing on that, the things I am doing, the things you're doing, and that is called a producer.
As we move on, in the Susan, we will come now hosting the video. And I can go for that.
You see, you can launch four. Yeah? Now, you see, all of them will be in this order.
Yeah?
Go there. So, you know, launch and show. Get? Yeah? Now, you launch more than three. It's this. Come up with me, you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Mm-hmm. So if it has 3 balls, Dr. Jerry has 2 balls. So we have one per session now. Mm-hmm. Dr. Jerry, to my launch. Call one after who am I? Mm-hmm. To my launch, your call. Mm-hmm. Then you're a PA, after he, it's like they're co leadership. It's practical.
Hello, sorry, I was just out of my desk. Let me let you in. Yeah? Hello. Hello, Ifeadi, I've let you in. Yeah? Hello. Yes. Hi. Uh-huh. Okay. 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 No problem. Okay. Okay. No problem. Okay. Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Jerry. Hello. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Hello, Dr. Jerry. Hello. Hello, Doc, can you hear me? Hello, Doc, can you hear me? Doc, can you hear me?
Morning.
Doc, how are you? I'm actually trying to get to call you.
Oh, yes.
Okay, you can lower your camera a little bit. You're just seeing up. Perfect. That's perfect. Yeah.
That's perfect. Okay.
Yeah, but the guy behind you, hiding him.
Yes, I'm hiding this one.
Okay, Ifeadi is having an issue, she's sorting herself out.
Okay.
So apparently you might have to go fast.
Oh, okay.
Okay. We actually like have 25 people in the waiting room.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
It's got a bit busy.
A bit busy. So, yeah. And actually, at least I got someone to help me out. with the staff, the staff. Yes.
All right. So do I load my own slides or what? What happened?
Yes. Load your slides. You'll have that control. Yeah.
So if you guide me through that, well, I did it, but I don't remember. So I go to my files, right?
Yes, open your file and let it be on desktop. It's open on the desktop and there's no other document open.
Okay, yeah? Cool. All right, so I can open.
Okay, then down here at the control, you can see share screen.
Yes, yeah.
Just share, maybe test it out.
Okay. I'm opening it.
Okay. Okay. Ah, welcome, Ifeadi. How are you?
I'm good. Is it bright enough? Can you see me? Yes, yeah. I can.
Yes, I can hear you.
Is it bright enough?
Anything you can do to brighten it?
Okay, so I think I'm going to try.
Okay.
I'm going to try.
Hi, Ifeadi.
Okay. Yeah, hi. Good morning, Dr. Jerry. How are you?
I'm good. You?
Very well, thank you.
Good luck with this morning.
Good luck, too.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, so let me just get back to trying to set up and get my data together.
Okay.
All right.
No problem. Okay, so Doc, you able to share? There's this green button here that says share screen. Just click on that. You found it? Let me help you. There's some things I'm looking for. You found it, or I take you through.
Unmute.
Yeah. Okay. You're able down here, down on the bar.
Yes, I can see the bar. I can see the video. I can see the more.
No, do screen share. There's something green with an arrow with pointing up.
Yeah, okay. Let me just do this. Now I can see it.
Uh-huh.
So you see, when I put the slides like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's see. I have to minimize that and then come back here.
Okay, let me finish. Yeah. Oh, perfect.
So it's here. Mm-hmm. Can you see it now?
Yes. Then there's this. Perfect. That's perfect now. Yeah.
You see it?
Yes, I see it.
Okay. I'm going to take it off again.
Okay. So I think the polls are ready. I made a change to the last one now. Yeah? To the last question, I made a small change.
No problem. No. Those are just drafts, so it's okay. Not a problem at all.
Okay, yeah. Great. Yeah. So what we will do, we'll open at 2:05, right? To just get guys to come in. There will be a PowerPoint playing, mm-hmm. and then some music. Then mm-hmm. at 11, we pick up. So guys will have been testing their audio and everything.
Okay. So I'm muting myself, right?
No, don't mute yourself.
I just leave it.
Or I can mute you, then I can unmute you, yeah.
Okay, so I don't touch anything now. I wait for you to say.
let me mute you from my end. Okay. Okay, so let's know what to do. Thank you. morning, everyone joining us today. Thank you very much for joining us. My name is Martin Wanjohi. You're welcome for this session. Today's session, we're going to be having two HR, seasoned HR professionals. That is Dr. Jerry Gule from IPM South Africa, and Ifeadi from Nigeria. We'd like to welcome everyone for this session. As we start this session, I'd just like us to introduce ourselves by name, maybe first name, and the country you're joining us from.
Hello, good morning. My name is Julius Yanga.
I would like us to introduce on chat, please. On the chat, just to a small session, just to help everybody know where we are at. So let's introduce ourselves on chat, and then let's introduce ourselves on the chat. And as we do that, I'd like to see what it is that we're going, what we need, our tools that we have at our disposal this morning. So, if you have a look at the slide that I'm sharing, down here we have the tools that you have available. You have chat available for you. Then you can chat what it is you want us to hear from you. Let's all be on mute for sound. And then we will also, this is the polls tool. We will have some polls at some point as we proceed on the session. And then you can raise your hand if you want to the attention of the host. So today we are privileged to have Dr. Jerry Gule, who will introduce himself well as we move on, and Ifeadi, who will be joining us shortly. So to start off, today's session is on change, culture, and learning. This is a 4-day series. We are on day 3. And we'd like to welcome everyone. Just by show of hand, who was in our last week's session? If you're in last week's session, just type a yes on chat so that we know who we carried forward with. Great. Okay, nice. So as you're joining us, maybe we'd also like to know one more little thing. Maybe you could share which industry you're in, maybe by on chat, whether you're in banking and finance, you're in manufacturing, you're in government or oil and gas, or in the travel and hospitality industry. You can share with us on chat. Something manufacturing, ICT. Yes, we are in HR, but in which industry are we in? I think, and thank you to the 101 HR professionals who have joined us this morning. I think we are all home in HR. And Dr. Jerry, maybe just to start us off, I'd like to pass the ball to you immediately. You can introduce yourself and then start the session.
Thank you very much for that introduction, and good morning, everyone. It is a privilege for one to be part of this series. This time, I'm going to just now upload my slides that I have. So I know that you want to see my face, so I'm going to move that out. See if we can move that out. Now let's see. Okay. Are you helping me with that? Martin?
Yeah. Okay, like what I can do, are you able to sort it?
Let's see. We are all learning, eh? let's see. Okay. Yeah, the slides disappear. Okay. So, anyway. As we sort that out, we will be able to load them up just now. We should. So share screen. Let's go there. Okay, so I think what I would like to cover this morning is just a little bit of who I am. I know I've been introduced. And then talk about the new world of work. Why are we talking about competencies? Why is it important to talk about the new competencies required? I think the competencies that are required, and I'm not going to, in the time that we have to go into, delve into a lot of things and definitions and so forth and so on. But just to say that leaders, team members, generalists and specialists do need these new competencies for the new world of work that we're in. And I think, particularly as we come out of the situations, the lockdowns around the world that we find ourselves in, that there will be short-term things, competencies that are going to be required for the short-term, and we also have to be thinking about the long-term.
Jerry, sorry to interrupt. Maybe you can do your slideshow so that we have a bigger view of the slides. Yes. Sorry to interrupt, yes.
Not a problem. So there we go. So I think the workplace as we have known it has changed. So we need new competencies. So for who I am, I'm not going to go through all that, but those are in terms of career, just to highlight that I'm the current CEO of the Institute of People Management, a 75-year-old organization today, and standing of course on the shoulders of great people who have led this organization. It was started in 1945. By a lady in the middle lands of KwaZulu-Natal here in South Africa. And I worked in corporate and I left corporate in 2016 and started my own coaching company, Gule Executive Coaching. So I still do coaching now, even though I'm working for the IPM. I think from an HR point of view, I really had a great time working for one of the oil majors here in South Africa, Total South Africa, for the Total Group. Based in Paris, as you would know, spent about 13 years there, and about 11 of those years, 11, 12, I spent as an HR person responsible for HR transformation, which is in basically diversity and inclusion in the context of South Africa, and the procurement function, running the procurement function at the time. I ended up running a consulting, internal consulting house, in which we're consulting to the rest of the African continent, the affiliates of Total. I was running a team that was responsible for that. I'm the current chairperson of the board of trustees. We run a charity that focuses on best schools in townships, and we've built one of the best schools in a township called Tembisa. Very proud about that, simply because I think it's key to think about what contribution are we making in our world today. So. And I'm also a board member of an organization called the Oram Institute and chairperson of their subsidiary profit-making company called Innova, Oram Innova. I'm a married man, married to Gugu, my wife. Dr. Gugu Gule, statistician by training. We have three children, Siyabonga, Apelele, and we have a daughter-in-law now, Magino. My highest qualification of education was at Harvard University. So it's a privilege for me to be here. Thank you, colleagues. So, just talking about competencies, there is an enduring model for HR work in the workplace. And this comes out of Dave Ulrich, as you know. I like this model because it basically, if you're an HR professional, you know that you're going to be playing within this spectrum of making sure that you take care of processes, that you make making sure that you take care of people, making sure that you focus on your operational issues and you also focus on the strategic issues. And I think as we come out of this particular situation, the lockdowns around the world, real strategic focus and operational issues, and of course, people, all these dimensions, in fact, are things that we need to be taking care of. And the question for us as HR professionals, line managers, consultants, everybody that they saw on the chart, is how good are we at each of these roles? Because we need to be developing, making sure that we're sharpening the sword all the time to make sure that we are strong. We can play these roles and play them very well, particularly if you are an HR professional. I mean, one of the key competencies for HR is, I'm sure my colleague will be talking about the relevance of HR. Really, at this time, when everybody's looking at how do we deal, how do we manage our people, what do we do, this is when we come to the fore. So being a change agent, questioning things, being a strategic partner, and of course, being an employee advocate, but also making sure that the bedroom, the back room is in order, the administrative activities, functions, which I know a lot of us don't like administration, right? It's one of those things that we procrastinate for the longest time. But we need to be expert on that, because that's really is an entry point. If that is not in order, a lot of things tend not to go well, or our credibility, we lose our credibility. So it's key
that, a lot of the money you lost,
that you are good at that.
Some from the people get college.
Moving on, the next thing, the next set of competencies are those of which I've picked up from the Creative Center for Center for Creative Leadership in North Carolina. I mean, this organization, these four leaders, I think these are core. Are core now, as we manage people remotely, will be core, in my view, in the short term and in the long term. These are some of the enduring competencies or skills that people would need to function effectively in an organization. I like the self-awareness, because the self-awareness talks about not just being self-aware where your shortcomings are as an individual. It also speaks to being aware of what's going on around you. So self-awareness is really key. When you know as a leader, what ticks you off and how can you control that? When do your emotions rise to the surface? Therefore, the good skills, competencies that you have get diminished. So self-awareness is key. And at a time like this, the ability to communicate and communicate effectively. Part of communicating is just being silent. Yeah, being quiet, contemplating, and then of course speaking out. I think from an HR point of view, we influence when we communicate, but it's how we communicate, when we communicate, what do we communicate? It's really important. And for any leader, I mean, this is critical. In terms of how do we model this skill, this competency as leaders. And of course, I've spoken about the fact that we influence. And it is sometimes, I mean, I was sitting in an interview one time and the guy says, how are you going to influence and make sure people that you don't see, actually, you are able to influence them, people that you don't meet in your work life. But if you get this job, those are the kinds of things you'd be managing people who are remote. This is a couple of years ago. Today, remote working, as we know, is part of where we are. And sometimes we stress because, and part of it is generated by lack of trust, not trust in your team members. Influence comes from a number of things. One of them, just simply trusting people who don't even trust themselves as a leader. So that's a key competence that I think, or skill that we need, that we're going to need as we go forward. Then the learning agility, like this one, because it applies, I mean, all this applies to all of us, because in order to lead others, the first thing that you lead, you have to lead yourself. So we must have these in our own lives. We must be able to lead ourselves, to lead others. But I like learning agility, because learning agility just speaks to the fact that you need to quickly know, in particular in this environment, what is it that you actually don't know, right? Quickly learn that. And things that you need to discard and learn new things, part of learning agility would be that. Moving on. So I have borrowed this from a good friend of mine, Michelle Chetty at Unilever, that in this post-COVID lockdowns, as we move forward, I think what we will need as critical competencies and skills is to look at what is required now, right? And being able to translate that and say, what does that mean? What is it that I need to do? How do I need to behave in this kind of environment? So protecting people is key. I mean, any HR person, that's our first call right now, is to be able to make sure that the people that work for the organizations that work, if you are consultants or whoever you are, our clients that you advise, are we coming up with solutions? Are we thinking about solutions, how we can physically protect people? So health and safety is key at the moment. In South Africa, we starting Monday, we actually have had the lockdown lifted for one third, I think, of the workforce. Not everybody is going back to work. And the key concern is, I mean, in the news all of last night was what people were saying, who was ready, who wasn't ready in terms of organizations for bringing people back to the workplace, making sure that they are physically safe to come back. They are protected from the virus as they come back. And I think that's a key role. That's something, if we haven't been dabbling in this area of health and safety, it's something that we need to be interested in and develop those skills to be able to work with the people that work in that area so that we can make a contribution. Secondly, making sure that our people are anchored as they come. In other words, they can understand, they feel safe from a mentally and socially and emotionally, that they feel safe as they come back to the workplace. We need to make sure that this is something that we as organizations are able to. So mentally, emotionally, financial safety also is key. I mean, we're all worried now. Where will my next paycheck? Where will my next income come from? My next revenue come from? So this is something that we need to school our hands and our minds, if as it were, to be able to deal with. Because I think in the medium term, in the now and in the medium term, this is going to be a key thing for us to be able to manage. So are we able to anchor the people that work for us or work with us or our clients in terms of mental and social? Thirdly, of course, the employee experience. As people come back to the workplace where we want them to be productive, are we creating conditions as people come? I mean, we know that there are some people already who are lifting the red card and saying, that's not Mr. Manager, Mr. Line Manager, Mr. Leader. That's not how you actually deal with. You may be frustrated. You may have a lot of emotional pent up. Back to self-awareness. How are you feeling as a leader? How are you managing that? What's your mechanism for self-management? Because as people come back to work, you want to give them the best experience under the conditions. They've been cocooned in their homes, frustrated, some of them. And maybe they bring those pent up emotions back here. But you want to create, as an HR professional, as a line manager, you want to create an environment where the experience of coming back to work is not as traumatic as people have been, or as traumatic as it is. In fact, I think for a long time, we're going to be feeling this trauma, because you want them to make sure that they are able to deliver. I just want to mention the fact that people can feel excluded in the workplace. So I talk about diversity, inclusivity, and reasonable accommodation. Some people will be working from home, but what culture have we created as an organization to make sure that when that baby makes noise or when that cat makes noise in the background, what kind of words do we say? Are we inclusive or accommodative? When that child cries and the mother who works for you but is working remotely has to attend to the child, because the child knows mommy's home. How inclusive is your workplace, is your culture as an organization to be reasonably accommodative? And let me just pause here and say, at least in the country where I am, South Africa, It is also expected that we'll employ persons with disabilities. Now, we know stats from both the World Health Organization, the ILO, tell us that, in fact, a lot of us, a third of us, or anything in this call here today, have a mental disability. You may not have declared it. We have some disability, it may be mental, it may be whatever, but we know that disability is there, and that's where reasonable accommodation comes in. So how is your culture, how is your organization prepared to really be inclusive, diverse, be accommodative of diversity and in all its forms, not just gender and race? Fourthly, of course, we have to save jobs. We have to save jobs, and we have to save salaries. It's a key requirement, it's a key skill. How do you do that? How do you structure things? How do you speak about that? I mean, as I said earlier, we're all worried about, will I actually have a job? I need to be moving on to round up and in terms of time. But I think this is key for us. So what does it mean to save jobs and to save salaries? It means every expenditure. As an HR professional, you need to understand how your organization makes money and loses money. Okay, where is the fat? You need to be an active participant advisor in that area of saying, okay, maybe we need to be looking at this so that we can save jobs. Maybe we should be structuring, there have been a lot of surveys that I've seen around remuneration. Maybe we should be structuring things this way in order to make sure that we can keep as many people in jobs, negotiate with the unions or whoever, so that at least we can retain salaries, keep people paid until a certain time where the governments are not able to supplement people's income. And of course, let me end with this. The others you will read for yourselves. And let me end with these two agile principles. Speed is going to be key, right? We need to develop that muscle. And finally, connectivity, staying engaged with your remote teams, making sure that you can connect across teams. I think that's important. I'm going to end it here just to say that this is going to be key as we go forward. Back to you, Martin.
Thank you very much, Doc. Now, so you stay online for Q&A. We can type the Q&A questions in the chat rather. And we'd like to do a small exercise for everyone in here. So we'd like to find out, what do we think? Yeah, now and in the future, competencies will remain will remain key to deliver exceptional business or public service results. What do we think as participants? Yeah, as we're taking that poll, Doc, in the meanwhile, you can end your screen share.
Okay.
Yeah. Just the same green button, there's somewhere stop. Okay. Something red, a small thing in red, yes. We're all learning. Great. Okay, so we have about 100 people who have taken the poll. Let's close in about 10 seconds. Okay, great. So as we end this poll, let's just share the results and we see what's the thinking of everyone. So everyone believes 2%, okay. Now the other thing is, kindly don't bother adding, it's more than 100%, but this gives us a general indication of where things are headed. Then maybe I can ask the participants, from Dr. Jerry's presentation on that last slide where he had listed the competencies, which one do you think is the key to survival in the workplace? Yeah, Dr. Jerry, maybe you can share that slide with the list of competencies you're going through, and then we can see what, yes. That was the second last slide, I think.
Okay.
Oh, let me just share it from my end. I think I have a presentation. Let me just share it from my end.
Okay.
Yeah.
You got it?
Yeah, got it.
Okay.
Okay. That's the question we're looking at. We can share which one we think. Sorry.
That's one. Yes.
This one. So let's current slide. What we believe is key. The one skill which we think if we have that, then we'll be able to survive in the workplace. We can share that on the chat. Okay. Okay. So I think as we continue looking at the chat and what everybody's saying, I think we're seeing agility, connectivity, anchoring employees, innovation and emotional intelligence. Agility, employee experience, build new skill. Okay, so as we continue to share that, I'd like to, Ifeadi, you're ready to go? Hello? Ifeadi, if you can start your video, I think we are ready to move into your session. Thank you very much, Doc. And I think maybe if you have any question for Dr. Jerry, you can type it on the chat and we'll be able to respond in the last 15 minutes of this session. Okay. Ifeadi? There's a question, if we can share the slides. We will be sharing the video plus the content later on after this session, so that we focus on this session.
Okay.
Okay, Ifeadi, you're good to go?
Yes, I think I'm good.
Okay, then I'll let you take over this and do the introduction. You can start your video.
Okay.
Great, welcome then.
Okay. Can you see me?
Yes, you're good to go.
All right, great. Good morning, everyone. Okay, so let me share my screen.
Slideshow so that it just broadens and fills the screen that everybody can be able to see properly.
Sorry?
I was saying you could do slideshow and then start from the beginning so that we're able to see it covers the whole screen.
Okay.
The view, yes. Just the view, yes.
Yes, okay, so. Can you see this now?
Yes, that's better.
Okay. All right, great. Okay, great. So, hi, good morning.
I think if Ifeadi is frozen, we can just hold for her to come back. Maybe Dr. Jerry, maybe as Ifeadi comes back,
yes.
There is a question that how can we protect jobs in small and medium enterprises without much financial, that don't have much financial stability?
Yes, I saw that question. It's a great question. Because in fact, that's what all organizations are saying. You know, you talk, we are smoking something. Are you smoking a weed? How can you talk about that at this time? But yes, so it's going to be difficult. You need the support of, Ifeadi is back. But I would say you need the support of big business to help you to do that. In other words, to be part of that value chain. Big business can help SMEs to survive.
Okay. Yeah, Ifeadi, nice to have you back. Maybe you can we can pick up from where we are. We've just picked a question. All just right. To yes, you can just pick up from where
okay,
we are.
Okay, all right, that's fine. That's fine. Apologies. I think that's really something happening with my data today. Okay, yes. So thank you, everyone. It's great to be here. So today we'll be speaking about the channels. And the key question I pose to us for startup is how relevant, you know, are we as HR professionals in the world of business today?
I think we have a small problem from Ifeadi's end. Yeah, we lost her. Once she's back, we'll pick it up from there. Okay, yeah, there's a nice suggestion that maybe she can stop her video. Once she's back, we'll have her do that. Yeah? Questions are coming through. Doc, maybe we can respond to this. There's a question here. Good morning, Dr. Jerry and everyone. What competencies are required for HR professionals in the manufacturing industry during and post-COVID?
Good one. There is another one before that.
Ifeadi, maybe you could shut down your video and then we just have the voice. Yes, it might help. Ifeadi.
I'm shut.
Yes, yes.
All right. So,
okay, I'm not sure if it's a video problem, but I'll try.
Okay.
I mean, let's go again. If it happens again, maybe I could try that. Yeah. So, yeah, so we'll talk about a number of things today. To look at the future of work, like where are we, you know, with everybody, every time we hear this future of work, future, like really what's future of work? And, you know, we'll look at, you know, the relevance of the HR leader and where we are today, you know, as HR professionals. So a little bit about me, I'm not going to say too much. Martin and I had a drag on this part, but I guess I have to do it. So yes, I've been in the workspace for about 15 years. I've worked in people management, consulting, and you know, it's been an exciting time, you know, these last few years I've spent. And I find, you know, the HR space has really evolved from where it used to be, especially here in Africa. At the time that I started my journey in HR here, I see how, you know, things have transformed and changed over time. So, I mean, you know, when I think about the relevance of HR, I look back, you know, like where we're coming from and where we're going. And it sort of puts a lot of things in perspective for me as an individual. So, currently, I lead HR at Tech Advance. It's a
software. Okay, I think we. Yeah. If I we'd lost you briefly, but you can just go on, yes. You can hear me? Yeah, okay.
Yes, I can, Martin. I can hear you. Okay, yes. Yes, so, like I was saying, I don't know at what point you guys lost me, but like I said, I've been in the HR space for about 15 years, and it's been quite an exciting journey. So moving on, you know, the first thing I'd like to, you know, focus on is like really the future of work. And I'd like all of us to really look at this image here. I'd be very happy to take your comments in the chat section. Like, really tell me, what do you see in this picture? You know, we're thinking about the future of work. What do you see here?
You can share your screen, Ifeadi.
Oh,
the screen, the screen. Yeah, the screen and share, yeah. Yeah, no worries.
Sorry. No. It's been a drag today. Sorry.
No problem.
Okay, so I'm asking about the future of work. Like, for us, what do you think the future of work is? You know, and I'd like us to look at this picture. I'd be very happy to take your comments in the chat section. What do you see in this picture? Like, what is the future of work that you see, right? Looking at this picture, I see a lot. Right there in the middle, you can see, you know, an entire, if you look at that, you see that white background and you see something that looks like, you know, maybe a white Apple mobile or something like that. But you can see, you know, that's a mobile, you know, a mobile device that is housing an entire ecosystem moved from where we used to know it. We see that, you know, mobile is driving a lot of things, digital is driving a lot of things. You know, technology is driving business, so the current events around the world. We see that there is really no better time, you know, to talk about the future of work than now. Like, for me, I don't know what other future, this is the future of work. You know, we're in the future of work now. I don't know how it's been in your country, but in my country, Nigeria, we've had to have some lockdowns, we've had to have some restrictions with movement and all of that. And you see, it's only the organizations who embrace technology who, it's really the businesses who have been able to embrace, you know, technology, who are thriving at this point in time. So looking at this image, like, you can see an entire ecosystem that is built around technology, data, things that are going on here. And you don't see a lot of people. I can only see two people in this image. This tells you that we are really, really moving towards a pure digital economy. HR professionals who look at this and who want to thrive in this kind of space are people who are going to talk about relevance, you know, in the coming future. Like, I do know that there are businesses right now that maybe can't go digital for so many reasons. For instance, if you're manufacturing, you can only digitize your processes, but carrying out the actual process, you really do have to get to work and all of that. But I mean, you see that there are many aspects of our work that we can digitize. I think for me, one thing I keep saying is that, you see, COVID-19 has only taken us maybe 5-10 years ahead of, you know, where we were eventually going to get to. So COVID-19 has pushed us 5-10 years forward in terms of technology adoption, digital, you know, digitizations, you know, moving our processes and our businesses into the digital space. COVID-19 has only just hastened that process for us. But was it ever going to happen? Yes. Were we all waiting for the future of work? Yes. But guess what? The truth is, here is the future of work. And only the organizations who adapted can thrive in this time. Only also, you know, like HR professionals who adapted, who caught up with the times, these are the only ones who are really, really going to thrive in this time. Imagine a HR professional who has no competence leading remote teams, a HR professional who has no competence, you know, working outside the norm, the regular routines. Those are the kind of people who are going to struggle now. So if we talk about building a culture, we talk about learning. There's something I always say, right? Learning never stops. Learning is continuous. Like, we have to keep learning. You have to keep adjusting. And I'll get to a point where I'm going to show you. For me, there are four things that I feel like HR professionals at this time should really, really be driven by. If you're a HR professional, you should be thinking, you know, in those four areas to lead and to direct, you know, your business at this time. And just to also briefly bring this into context, I'm sharing with you this image by the feature of the Institute for the Future in a report that they had sometime last year called the Future Work Skills 2020. So it's like something that they do annually, and you know, they put together some skills that they feel will be driving work, you know, going forward. So you find that a lot of the competencies and skills that you have here, to be very honest, it looks like these guys saw into COVID-19. It looks like they saw into 2020. Now, they've identified 10 skills, but these 10 skills are driven by six key factors. Now, these key factors, you see computational world, superstructured organizations, globally connected world, new media ecology, rise of smart machines and systems, extreme longevity. So to be very honest, I do not see any trend that is happening in this time that has not been covered here, right? Talk about a computational world. The world is driving towards sensors, towards, you know, so much data and digital information. You know, we're coming to a digitized world where everything is, you know, going to be programmable, where you're going to just program things and they're going to work. But as a HR professional, are we ready? Like, are we at that point? Have we brought ourselves, you know, to that point of knowledge and development, you know, to help us to lead the, you know, the workforce? Like, we can lead a workforce that we do not even understand as professionals. You know, you see the superstructured organizations, a globally connected world. I mean, today we are speaking here, Dr. Jerry from, you know, South Africa, myself from Nigeria, a lot of, you know, everyone who is attending here from Zambia, Kenya, Ghana, all over the place. Like, so we are digitally connected, and, you know, if we're going to share ideas as a continent, as a people, as professionals, you see the kind of technology that we are using, you know, to connect to each other, to share the peculiarities of what's going on in our different countries and in our different worlds. HR professionals, we've got to come to that level where we know that, you see, the world, the work, and even the worker themselves have changed drastically, right? So there are a lot of things driving the world right now. But to be honest, looking at this report again, I read this report in detail last year. Looking at this report again, I cannot but see every single thing that is happening in the world today in this, you know, in this image, in this pictorial, representation. You have transdisciplinarity. We all, you know, as HR professionals, we need to start looking at the fact that people got multiple skills, want to do multiple things. Are we talking about cognitive load management? I don't know how many of you guys have been driven crazy by the information in the media, or, you know, everything going on with COVID-19. That's cognitive load management, you know, being able to sift through information and take what's relevant and jump what's not relevant. Take what's relevant for you as an individual, for your business, and, you know, be able to put them in context. Or is it virtual collaboration? I mean, the mere fact that we're having this meeting today is virtual collaboration. Is it social intelligence? Have you looked at, like, social interactions online? How intelligent are we as HR professionals? How exposed and how acceptable or receptive to change? So there's a lot, you know, that is driving the world right now. New media literacy. So today, Zoom is booming. You and I on Zoom, you know, having a webinar. Look back a few years, you know, before now, did we have a Zoom? All we had was a Skype where you had to create an account and da, 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 da. And somebody just came up on there and said, you know what, junk it, let's disrupt it. Just do something that anybody that has a link can just log in. And that's why we are here. Look at, you know, social media. Look at how much content, intellectual selling is going on in the digital and in the media space, right? Look at, there's so much that is going on. The thing is, as HR professionals, are we looking at these details? Are we looking at this data? We are leaving in mind, you know, a workforce that is focused on these areas. How are we leading that workforce? How are we prepared? And, you know, what's our readiness to lead the workforce of the future? Right, so we have to be prepared. If we have to be relevant in business, then we have to be prepared to lead, you know, even in with the complexities and the ambiguities of the current world that we find ourselves in. So it's a lot, and to be honest, I'll be very happy to share this so that anybody who wants to look at it can look at it in further detail. And I'll also put it out on my LinkedIn profile, you know, for some of us to look at it, you know, in further detail. But there is so much going on right now. Am I speaking about the rise of, you know, smart machines? A few weeks back, I saw that students in Japan graduated virtually, and then they had robots who would come up as themselves. So they had robots with screens of themselves. So for instance, if Ifeadi was a graduating student, there would be a robot that would have my picture and would come forward to the awarding, you know, professors, and they would have like a wave to greet and say well done and congratulations. And, you know, that was how, you know, they had their graduation, right? They used the graduated students with robots and all of that. So it's a lot of things, right? The world is at a place where it's no longer what we used to know. We have a new normal. And like I said earlier, COVID-19 only took us years further. Like, a lot of us were sitting on things, taking our time. But I think what COVID-19 has done now is that it's taking us 5-10 years ahead of where, you know, where we would have gotten to in 5 years or in 10 years, taking our time. COVID-19 just escalated that and spread it up, you know, and we really have no choice but to adapt and to connect, you know, with the new world and the new normal that we see. So to function effectively, you know, in the current world, as a HR leader, you've got to be, you know, a relevant leader, and you've got to be a leader who is not driven by processes as usual, right? You know, for me, a lot of times I always tell people, processes and procedures, policies sometimes kill innovation. So sometimes you have something that has been written in a particular way, to be followed in a particular way, to be done in a particular way, and then you find out that sometimes, you know, when you're trying to follow those rules and those regulations, sometimes sort of kill it. Right now, I don't know how many of your policies are still relevant, given the current situation of things, but the truth is, people are rewriting new policies, bring your device to work policies, different policies are currently ongoing. But for me, are these the real drivers of the business at this time? I don't think so, right? The real driver of the business at this time is creativity, is innovation, is thinking out of the box. That's
hello, Ifeadi. I think we lost Ifeadi a little bit. Maybe as before she comes back, we can just run something small. And then we'll launch this poll. Let's see, let's take this poll before Ifeadi, as we wait for Ifeadi to come back. Now, given the peculiarities of the VUCA economy, which of these leadership qualities should be top for a relevant HR leader? Okay, let's take that and let's share our opinion, what we think. Okay. We'd like to thank the 164 HR professionals who have joined us today for this session. Welcome, and we appreciate your time. As we continue with this, we'll close at exactly 1 minute, 10 seconds, or when we have at least 100 people have voted. Ifeadi, you're back with us. We're just taking a poll. We're waiting for you as we take this poll on screen right now. Yep.
All right. Yeah. Sorry about that.
No problem. It's technology.
And we have to adapt.
There's learning in this learning session. Yeah. And this is where things like being innovative. In my program, I had not planned it to happen this way, but when things happen, you adapt.
Yes. Right? You adapt and make the best of the situations. Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
As we close this poll, let me close this poll and then share the results, and then you can share your screen and we can continue with where we are at. So, so that's what people would think about. We're running the poll of given the peculiarities of the VUCA economy, which leadership qualities should be top for a relevant HR leader? You know, and I'm seeing from our team, people are thinking as of the opinion that the ability to lead through complexities and ambiguity are one of the key top skill for a relevant HR leader. You know? Okay, so let me let you continue. Your screen share has gone off, so you can share your screen once again. Okay,
so great. So thank you, Martin, for taking this short time to really do that poll, because I think it's really timely. It's really at the perfect time we're talking about, you know, the VUCA world and the VUCA economy. So yes, I totally agree with the over 70% of you who think that, you know, the ability to lead through complexities at this time should be more of a focus for HR professionals. So yes, I agree. And like I said, to be honest, I am very sure that maybe up to 50% or 80% or I don't know how many percent of our current policies have really been disrupted. So even our policies are being disrupted. So we have to, as HR people, we have to get ready that, like, you know, the worst can happen at any point in time. It can get bad at any point. Anything can happen. Like, nothing is given in this world where we are in right now. I mean, no one saw COVID-19 coming. Even I didn't see it coming. But what do? When this hits, the best you can do is bounce back. You know, as a HR professional, you have to also, you know, develop the really, you know, resiliency skills, bounce back, you know, from tough times and be able to lead. Like, we have to stand up for the businesses that we lead. We have to stand up for the people that we champion. We can't back down now. We can't give up now. This is the time for us to really stand up and bring, you know, our leadership skills to fore. And then, you know, to lead as a HR professional and in this time, to be a relevant HR professional in this time, that's why I say, you know, I have these four pillars for me. You must be creative. You must be innovative, you must have design thinking, and you must think employee experience. These four areas, that's it for me. Like, when you must lead people. I wish we had enough time, we could have delved a little bit into design thinking and employee experience. But let me tell you a little bit about employee experience, right? And design thinking, right? So design thinking helps you to create, you know, like, simple solutions around managing your people problems, right? And employee experience simply makes you look at your employees the same way you look at your customer. So, like, you place your employees at a very high pedestal where you're sure, you know how we always say that the customers are always right, but really we know that the customers are not always right, but, you know, we treat them as if they're right. So yes, sometimes you have to adopt that to adopt that philosophy managing your employees. And the truth is, you know, there was a discussion that I started on LinkedIn sometime last year where I had to pull in a lot of, you know, like, HR heavyweights across the continent. And I was asking, my question was, what should HR be focusing on right now? Is it employee experience? Is it employee retention? Is it results? Or is it employee experience? And you see, a lot of people, over 70%, 80% people tended towards experience. And a lot of arguments show that, I mean, we've been doing results, we've been doing retention,
But the truth is, at this point, it's really difficult. Like, we are even working with people who might not even, who are not even thinking about being retained. Like, before they join into a job, they're thinking about their exit. And I shared that, you know, pull from an experience I had. And I interviewed a candidate who, we called a candidate for an interview who declined to attend the interview, but he asked us for a meeting. And when he came for the meeting, he said, oh, he had just resumed another job and he didn't want to take on a new job at this time. But he wanted to establish a relationship because he sees himself moving in the next 10 months. So he's just started a job just about a month. And he's looking at moving within the next 10 months to meet his career goals and some career aspirations, you know. So that's why I say we are in a world where even the employees we have are not the kind of employees we used to have. Their thinking is different. The mindset is different. Everything in this world right now is different. So even our normal in 2019 is no longer normal in 2020. In 2020, like, things are so different. It's not like, I'm looking at 2019 and I'm looking at 2020. For me, it seems like they are worlds apart. Like, so much has changed in this short time. And as professionals, what do we do? You have to be on top of your creativity game to be relevant, on top of your innovation game. Think, design thinking, like, solve your simple business problems using the design thinking concept. You know, which just helps you to put simple steps to solving, you know, regular day-to-day business problems. And then employer experience. What kind of experience are your employees getting at work? So one of the HR professionals, when I ran that pool I spoke about, one of the HR professionals said something that was quite intriguing. He said, it doesn't matter how long people stay with you, right? What matters is that they have a good experience, and that they, when they have, when people have a good experience, they are happy, they give you their best. And it doesn't matter how long they stay. And even if they leave sooner or later, give them an opportunity to be your brand ambassadors out there, you know, and give them an opportunity to be, you know, an alumni that is strong and also backs up your business in different, you know, ways. So these four pillars for me are key for every relevant HR professional or any HR professional who wants to be relevant in today's VUCA economy: creativity, innovation, design thinking, employee experience. These four areas are the key. Above all, we've also seen COVID-19 force us, you know, to be more human. So empathy is really going to lead in the new world of work. Empathy, putting yourself in people's shoes, is going to lead, because lots of leaders are having experiences now that they never, ever thought they could have. So every...
Okay, I think we lost Ifeadi again. So let me invite Dr. Jerry. Dr. Jerry, you're there with us?
Yeah.
Yes. I think today there's a few challenges with the internet, I think, from Ifeadi's side. Maybe we can take a few questions.
Yes.
We can take a few questions. There was one question that I think I would like to give it to you. What's the downside of emotional intelligence? Is there any known downside of it, of emotional intelligence, of someone being emotionally intelligent?
Yes, I saw that question. That's a good question. And again, I think it's really our understanding of what emotional intelligence is all about. I mean, it is about understanding your own emotions, that you're an emotional human being. And there is actually nothing wrong with having emotions. In fact, emotions get us out of all sorts of dangers, isn't it? So, and when we deal with our emotions effectively, control them, right? Being on top of them, understanding what they mean, and being genuine to them. But it is our body speaking to us. So what is the downside? I think in the current, call it militaristic organizational cultures that we have created, it's a bad thing to have emotions. I heard for the first time a board in an organization where they said, our CEO, it's time for you to go home because you need to take a sabbatical. You can see that you are stressed. They have given you targets and all that. We can see you are stressed. The body, it reacts to, if we suppress our emotions, the body is going to react. You know how the mind works. So I think emotional intelligence, it's understanding ourselves and understanding what happens around us. Is there a downside? I'm not sure. I think it's when we exercise our social and our emotional, we are genuine people, we are authentic people. So I personally don't see a downside to it. In fact, what I see is that it then brings the best out of us because we are being real. We're not putting a facade, a mask. Of course, we must put a mask in the days of COVID. But you understand what I mean, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. There was another question of, I think people with questions, you can put your questions on chat, then we can respond to them.
Yeah. There is another one, Martin, on a colleague from the manufacturing sector. Yeah, he says, what competencies should people, HR professionals in manufacturing have? I think Ifeadi dealt with that perfectly in terms of the skills that we need. But I would just say, manufacturing deals with, for me, as HR professionals, what we need to do is to understand our own business. I always talk about get back to the floor, understand what your organization is doing, what your people are doing. So I see here being not afraid of tech. You know, as technology comes to your manufacturing plant, do you understand? Because your role is to recruit the people that can deal with that technology. So you've got to love technology. You've got to, manufacturing is safety, all written all over it. Because if you don't manufacture safely, then you're going to have all sorts of problems as an organization. I think Ifeadi, in a nutshell, I think she answered those questions, this particular question. All right?
Okay. There's a question here from Lisa Molo. How do you do performance management on employees working remotely?
Yes.
That's a whole topic by itself. We covered that in our session on management of remote employees. Yes. Yeah. So, Amolo, we will have this video coming in. Don't worry. We will share that video over. Hello? There's someone. Ifeadi, is that you?
Okay. I think it's Ifeadi.
Okay. Okay, so we had a whole session on remote managing performance of remote employees. Liz, and our apologies to everyone. We will send out that recording in the next 24 hours. Check your email. We'll have a link to the recordings for performance management. That was day 4 and 5, about 5 days of e-learning. Liz, why we can't go to it? It's about a 30 minutes session. We'd like to take some more questions before we actually close, and our apologies of going over time. The session is supposed to be an hour exactly, but we try to keep to the hour. We have any questions from the audience? Any questions from the audience? Okay, if at this presentation, we will share it also today within the next 24 hours so that we all have it, and then we can move forward from here. Maybe before we end this session, I'd like to ask anything from the audience you can share on the chat with everyone. We'd like to hear your thoughts. We'd like to hear your comments regarding this. And as we do that, I'd like to share. Okay, let's keep the comments coming, and then we can be able to. Okay. Let's see our comments. Okay. There's a question, Doc. How would you recommend HR professional develop a communication strategy post-COVID?
Okay. The first thing, if you have a communications department or marketing, talk to those people. That's the first thing I would recommend. And then launch your communication program. I mean, in the organizations that I'm part of right now, I found that the communications people from the marketing department have actually been very, very helpful. So there's been a lot of collaboration. That's what I would say as a short answer.
Another question that came some time back, can you over-communicate during this period of COVID, post current and post-COVID? Can you have a case of over-communicating?
No, communication is just that, you know, you can never, ever over-communicate. The thing is, it must be relevant. So you need to sit back. I always use what I call the four eyes test. So if you are sending out something to ask someone else to have a look at it and say, is this what we want to say? And also remember, it can't be a one-time thing, a one-night stand, as it were. So if you start a culture, you must maintain it. So you must have that in mind as you structure your communication going forward, that this is the culture you want to create in the organization. But no, you can never, ever over-communicate, I don't think.
So, Doc, there's another very interesting question from Motoni Njeru. What tools would you recommend to enhance emotional intelligence, agility, and functional leadership?
Tools. I mean, the first easiest tool is actually just arranging for people to get feedback. I mean, that's how you learn. Have someone observe. This is what helped me greatly. I had my manager, when I was making presentation, have my manager sit there, and his job was not to sit and critique. Well, to critique, but it's also to say, what did you put across well? What did you fail to put across? So then you can improve the first time. Same with emotional intelligence in the workplace. How do I come across? How do I show up in meetings and everything that we do? So you have a partner. That's it. Just cost you nothing. Have a partner, a collaborator that will help you to improve your skills. That's what I think. Then you can go into all these research tools. If I just back, I think, to say a last word.
Okay. Welcome back, Ifeadi. You are doing a Q&A. We knew you'd be back. So let me present it. No problem. It's technology. Yes.
Okay, so I think I'm actually done with my presentation. I think that was the last part. But just to conclude, I was saying that, you know, for a HR professional to be relevant at...
Hello, Ifeadi, you can hear us? Okay, what we do, let's wait for her to come back, then we can, there's a question that we had here. There's something about domestic violence.
Yes.
Just a concern, been following news from different countries, and the issue of domestic violence is on the rise due to some factors like confinement because of COVID-19. Mm-hmm. The stress level is high. My question, post-COVID, will HR role major in counseling session? Just thinking out loud about it.
Yeah, so it's a good thought. I mean, I'm sorry to say that in my own country, here I am in South Africa, we have seen, the last time, thing over the weekend, was reported that 14 people had been killed by their partners. And wow. It's sad. And mostly these, the people who suffer these things are women, which makes you really, really sad to see. We all know about wellness programs, I suppose. And I think it's part of the menu that HR should have, you know, having employee support programs in the workplace, because they are really, really vital, confidential, vital. HR should be the most trusted department in an organization. The HR professionals themselves, people can confide, and you refer them to the help that is there. So I think, yes, it is true. I mean, we should be, our organization should be doing it even now. Those support services, our people having, and families having opportunities to call for assistance where they need that assistance, both from the public as well as the private sector. And collaboration is the key here.
Okay, great. I'm seeing there are no any other questions. I think there being no other question, and I think we're still on time. We're just 10 minutes past the session. Oh yeah, there's another question for you, Doc. Yes. How do you improve employee work safety during this COVID on matters of accidents at work?
Can you repeat that?
How do you improve employee work safety during this COVID on matters of accidents at work? and also bearing that the employee's home or workplace is their home.
Yeah, we have to do things differently because we know how much stress people are under, have been under, will be under. So part of what we, here there's a protocol. Before, as part of just protecting people, organizations have been asked, employers have been asked, make sure that when people come for their shifts, those that are actually going to the physical workplace, apart from those that are working from home, physical workplace, you want to make sure that in the morning or whenever they come in, there is a proper check that PPE is correct. The people are alert to know what is going on in the workplace because that you can only check. I mean, as they do in the minds, you just want to make sure that people are alert. So you almost do a daily induction, if you will. But it's a short one to say, guys or ladies, this is where we are. This is what we're coming to do. Please make sure that you take care of this. That's what the line managers and supervisors should be doing. And of course, assisted by their HR practitioners.
Great. Okay, so just to end up this, I was just sharing our session for tomorrow. Our session for tomorrow is purely on learning and development. We'll be looking at how do we need to rethink around learning and development continent-wide. So if you're keen around learning and development, which every HR should be, join us tomorrow at the same time, that's 11 to 12 p.m. East Africa time, 10 o'clock Central and Southern African time, and 9 o'clock in Lagos. We'd like to thank everyone. We will try and liaise with Ifeadi and do whatever sessions we feel we're missing, and then we can share a complete session. But in terms for now, maybe before we wind up, I'm seeing Ifeadi is back. We can just invite her for the last word. No? Let me just say, let's invite her for the last word and then we can close this. Again, we'd like to thank the 100 plus HR professionals who joined us. Actually, we hit 168 at some point this morning. Yeah. I think I've lost Ifeadi again. I think might be problem issues with her internet. So unless there's any other questions, we'd like to bring this session to the end. Dr. Jerry, last words?
Yeah, no, thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. Nice to meet with colleagues from across the continent. It was great. Thank you very much.
You're welcome very much. So we'd like to thank you, everyone. Thank you for taking your time. Let's meet tomorrow. And then maybe just before we close this session for today, I'd just like to know from the participants, would you like us to continue this every Tuesday and Wednesday with HR professional panelists from various countries in this country, in this continent? Just by opinion. Okay. So we will add this to our list of activities and have every Tuesday and Wednesday, even after COVID, and then we can learn and grow together. So thank you very much, everyone, and join us tomorrow, 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock. Thank you very much and have a great day, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Martin. Bye.
Bye.